I'll wait. We're only asking for an hour, and thanks for not arriving late. The set is all but missing in action. A bench, two boxes, some loose paper for traction. And before moving forward without missing a beat, I'll apologize profusely for this raging DC heat. Now, this simplicity is not about avoidance, since scene and setting are of little importance. Me on Mount Olympus, her in a park, at the time of these events, just after dark. Yes, technically, each of us is in their own place alone. So our interactions occur entirely on the phone, which is of course just an extended metaphor, not acted out literally, since we wouldn't want to bore you with sound effects, projections, or other such pomposity. Instead, we are relying on our verbal virtuosity. And beyond that, perhaps a song or two will come upon. But before you start, let's not forget that pirates can happen to anyone. And if not pirates, then we'll settle for the copter from Miss Saigon. Look, you might think it's easy being Hermes, the messenger god. Or to some, I might as well be a stranger or a fraud. Mythology of the Greek sorts has been passé for centuries. So me and my Greek cohorts have been out doing as we pleased. Ares kept fighting, Aphrodite still delighting. Dionysus is on Broadway while Hades went his own way. And while I cannot tell you what is up with Athena, I can tell you that my son Pan is playing the biggest arena in Europe, and I would be proud if I didn't find his music so soulless and loud. But I'm getting off track. It's time to get back, and diligently. The minutes are passing, and seriously? Come on, pick up the phone. I'm tired of staying up all night alone. It starts with a ringing. Just a ringing in your ear. It starts long after the birds and the sun all but disappear. Exactly. Every beginning starts with lead. Just one immortal being trying to get ahead.
Starting over.
another chance to try and get it right. And I am gonna try starting over. Yes, I'm starting over. And this is far from the beginning. Another draft, another chance to try. I have given up on winning.
Time after time, after na na na.
while the phone's ringing. With trepidation and romance, all I need is one good song, a quiet song that's not too long, a song with some romantic spiel that tells you how I really feel. A song I'll write.
One single day.
tonight, I can write the saddest lines. Write, for example, the night is shattered. Blue stars shiver in the distance. The night wind revolves in the sky and sinks. Pablo Neruda. Writing verse might not be in your natural vernacular. So let me introduce the motivations of my character. I'm writing to write, not to make light, but to shed light. Not to set right, but to rewrite. To say something important, to rhyme, to sing, to dance, to feel, to make what's now long past again feel real. And maybe when I'm done, I'll sleep again. Sleep, easy knowing the where, the how, the why, the when, the reason why I lie awake, and words like oxygen intake. What motivates to hide the blur, the truth in songs that I write for her?
Have you ever watched the dew on the grass start to glisten? It literally litters the ground, like on some mission, and serves as just another mirror of my own ambition, as I watch the swans on the pond wake and form into their herds. I'd like to make a small confession. I have my own artsy obsession, not in writing, not in words, but in the area of fashion. Though on this stage I haven't yet declared a major, you can bet that I am far from undecided on costuming. I'm quite set. It was on this bench that in a dream, a dress, a vision came to me. Every accent, every seam, all part of one cohesive theme. The color, a fantastic blue. But not of any normal hue. This is not a blue majestic. No room for purple in my fabric. This one reflects the great Atlantic, deep and rich and dark and frantic. And in this cloth, there runs a thread, the color of which, of course, is red, and sprinkled in some ribbons and ties that reference the starry skies. He's not the only worker, staying up awake all night, because I've been quite the dressmaker, sketching here by lamppost light. And on this dress, I've set a deadline for when my work is done and made, like the last stop on the red light, I'll get off the street.
What are you doing? Not on a bench anyway. Don't you have a place to stay?
My roommate's boyfriend's visiting, so now I'm out here shivering.
No, you don't have to be there, right? It must be freezing this time of night.
Just for now, I've got no place to go, because classes don't start for 9 hours or so.
You can come for a visit. I'd buy you a ticket. I know you'd enjoy it. Just say the word.
No.
Like it here, up high and clear, summer all year, and no one studying the past, no test to take. It's always break, make what you make, don't worry, it won't last. Oh, won't you please just visit me, give me one day off to visit.
the ground. You question me, then look around. Every day the same sensation.
I
go off and start to fight, and I just sit there patiently.
We all know
this real fight. I
call you through the missed occasions. Late night calls and protestations. Morning yawning and my dawning realization. I know it's far. Hire a car. Leave all the fuss and jump on a bus. And no, it's insane, but hop on a plane. I am done procrastinating. Now no time for hesitating. Cause you make the heavens complete. We build you a statue from concrete. You are the wings on my sandal feet. So it's time for you and my family to meet.
What a treat.
You know I'd visit in a minute if it wasn't for my family, but when it comes to mortals, they highly disapprove. So I'd appreciate it if you met on their home turf before I made my move.
Besides that, I'm busy with class. I really need to stay and study if I'm going to pass.
What's the use? It's just an excuse.
At least it's better than yours. I wouldn't want to anyway. Your family's a bunch of bores.
I highly disagree. For better or worse, they are a basis of a mythology. And also, while no one gets along with my mother, I have a sort of feeling you'd like my brother.
Dionysus, god of wine and drama? Please, I'd rather meet your mama. When it comes to him, I really truly doubt that he's the type of guy that I would ever be about.
Now, you could be forgiven for feeling the same, but that is only because I've neglected to give you her name. Her name is Ariadne, with a capital A. And some of the Greek myth buffs among you might be thinking, hey, that's Dionysus' wife. Alas, it's true. You see, this is doomed. But what else is new? My brother Dionysus meets her in a year or so while he's in town promoting some show. But at this point in time, since she doesn't quite yet know, I'd appreciate it if you kept her on the down and low.
Looking over my shoulder, come what may, I reach the harbor upon the water.
Like to share with you my very favorite story. And some of you might not care, but every word of it is true. And though I've told it often, it is no worse for wear. I was born to Zeus and Maia, quite the royal couple, but instantly I started drama, got in loads of trouble. They say even as a babe, I was awake all night. And I can attest, within a week, I got in my first fight. And not with just anyone whose tread might have been hollow, no. My first fight was with the god of light, the great Apollo.
Every day, getting older, a little closer. Come what may, life's getting shorter, I see a border.
Until I stumbled stupidly upon Apollo's cattle, which, with reflection, I should have left alone. But as quite the mischievous youth, I thought I should take them for my own. So one by one, and by their tails, I whirled them to the dark blue sky. And that's the origin of clouds, in case you ever wondered why.
Breathe.
He caught me red-handed before I disbanded the whole herd of cattle and felt I should pay. There was no alternative. My fun was done. So I decided to get up and run. And as a child, I was quick. And had there been no hurdle, I might have escaped. But I tripped on a turtle. And as I lie awaiting hell, I noticed it was just a shell. An empty shell, in which I stretched 5 strings made from Apollo's herd. And when those strings I fully plucked, made sounds of sorts I never heard. And I know you might feel tempted to call me a liar, but honestly, I say to you, that's how I made the lyre. And when Apollo reached me but stopped to catch his breath, I had to admit upon threat of pain or painful death, there was no sound as beautiful as those emitting from my strings. No ringing, rustling, singing, bustling, no. Not even godly things could make a sound half as profound as that shell I'd found right on the ground. But the question remains, will she stay to hear my great creation, or grow tired of being the object of my attention, the subject of my affection? It's also foolish to ignore the prospect of her objection, because there really is no method of predicting her reaction. And I apologize if my tone ever gets too self-deprecating, because I find that musicals are at their best when motivating. You can rain on my parade. You can wheeze like Adelaide. You can tap and moan that it is too darn hot. But I do hear the people sing. I've got the world on a string, and I am not throwing away my shot. Listen, if theater is a temple, then this stage is a confessional where audience and actor can unite in hypothetical debate on life, the tone of which be cynical or lyrical. Regardless, it is the writer who will always win. Finn.
Our birth, it was that threat that stitched the earth that long after we all are dead and punished.
tortured souls go past the trees whose trunks are hollow, the three-headed dogs who bellow and off into the night. And in that place where the labyrinth ends, far from nigh as holy well, deep in the ground where it's hot and low, where no mere man can follow, and where all you hear's an echo of a song in a distant height. It's a long, long walk to Providence. It's a long, long walk from sea to shining sea. It's a long, long walk from from him what she refused from me, when she lets him grant her immortality.
It's not that I was afraid to die, it's just that I was reaching
for what?
The sky.
In the life of every work, the point at which one goes berserk, where rhymes collapse and show their quirk, the writer enters a sort of haze, their structure like a maze, hits walls and bumps. And the point at night when the eyes tire. It must be the time to retire. But I'm not done. Moreover.
Would you like me to take over?
Yes, please.
All this babbling must now cease. There's still one story to deliver, and perhaps the ending is a bummer, but it's the story of last summer. It started when Zeus, god of lightning, and his usual womanizing, fell in love with the housewife of the Venus Park. And so, Zeus quickly shrunk and metamorphed into a chipmunk.
Thank you. what theater needed was newer forms. Edgy, inviting. Turns out, all I really wanted was better writing.
On this seventh day, I'll rest upon my bed.
And there even the sirens shout out.